Good morning, everybody. Just heading home from the gym. I don't know about you, when you're in the gym, do you listen to music? Or do you listen to podcasts? Or what do? Well, this morning what I did, just for fun, is I listened to a lecture, just to recap on one of my favorite people to follow, Dr. Stuart McGill. He was a PhD at Waterloo up in Canada. I believe he is now retired from being in the lab, but is a wealth of knowledge on low back, really back, spine, hip. One of the top experts in the world. So if you're not familiar with Stuart McGill, you should look him up and you should read and study his stuff. He's got a book called Back Mechanic, which is awesome. And this is something that all of us should have in mind and should think about when we're differentially diagnosing low back pain. And just recently I was talking to a good friend of mine, Dr. Ed LaCara, AKA the movement-based chiropractor, and I'll tag him on this so he can chime in as well. He is also a wealth of knowledge, and he's a guy I turn to often when I just want to get his take on how he does things. And so anyway, in going through and watching Dr. Stuart McGill's lecture, one of many where he repeats these concepts, he talks about motions, postures, and loads. And just a side note, if you haven't checked it out yet, and if you're wondering how to even get started with taking important principles like this and corrective exercise and functional movement, how do you add that to your practice? How do you get this in front of your patients? Which, I mean, I'm telling you, I mean, there's no way to candy coat it. If you're a chiropractor, you really have to know this stuff. I didn't used to know it, and I look back at my ignorance and all the stuff I missed in practice and all the myths and untruths that I perpetuated to my patients, and now how I'm doing it now, and the improved results and just better satisfaction of knowing I'm following the best evidence-based approaches. Go to our site, movableuniversity.com, and check it out. There's a lot of cool resources on there. And comment and let us know what you think, and let us know what your opinion is on corrective exercise and functional movement. I mean, let's open up this debate a little bit. If you're listening to this on a podcast, hopefully if this audio is good enough, I don't have my headset, but if you're listening to this on a podcast, then same thing. You can go to Facebook, go to our YouTube channel, comment, hit us up, let us know what you think about this, because I think more chiropractors need to be talking about this topic, and we need to find especially the chiropractors who don't think this is important and kind of figure out how to get them in one camp. That's fine. Maybe, you know, sprinkle this in periodically and pique their interest, but the main group, the main camp of chiropractors that I'm really trying to reach and appeal to is not those that are already sold on that exercise is important, but the people who are on the fence, the people who don't really know. They know there's something more important out there. They know they want to do more. They're not sure how. And is it adding some kind of like laser wrap for the feet for neuropathy? No. Is it buying some expensive machine to put in a room and stick everyone on and charge them $5,000 a piece? No. Not to say that that kind of stuff can't help with things, okay? So I'm not trying to badmouth that stuff. I'm not naming any names of exactly what kind of treatments or therapy that is per se, but you kind of know where I'm going with my slight passive aggressive comments here. It's that functional movement, active care, that is where the future of really healthcare is. It's where the past of it has been as well. It's just the minority of practitioners actually do this stuff or learn it. So back to Dr. Stuart McGill, he talks about when you're trying to understand someone's pain, okay, the reason they come into you with this chronic low back issue is you have to do an assessment. And he talks about that, I mean, he takes 3 hours to do someone's workup, someone's assessment, which you might think is extreme, but you know what, to be honest, the way we do a workup with someone, with anyone, takes about really 2 hours, and it's spread over 2 days. So on the first visit, we take a detailed history. We ask them lots of questions. What things make it better or make it worse? So we're trying to see like provocation of the pain, really like understand the mechanism of injury. And then we do an exam, and in the exam, we're looking for any sort of red flags or, you know, signs that jump out. Then we take x-ray, we take some special imaging. It's not that the x-ray tells us where the problem is, not at all. We find the problem on the patient, and then the imaging tells us what's the best mechanical way to start addressing this? And that's very important. And that's a concept that's stressed in really all the techniques that I've ever learned in chiropractic. to an extent, I should say. In Gonstead, it's stressed. You find the problem on the patient, x-ray tells you how to fix it. Chiropractic biophysics is really about, you know, changing curves, modeling the spine. So they're really more of looking at x-ray and trying to find the problem. And I understand where that's coming from, because there's lots of spine modeling studies to show that, like, for example, cervical spine, if you have a complete loss of cervical curve or cervical kyphosis, you have an 18 times higher likelihood of chronic neck pain and issues. And just mechanical loading studies have just shown that abnormal mechanics are going to break down the spine. So structure dictates function is something you hear all the time. Well, function dictates structure as well. So it goes both ways. So it's like looking at this from multiple lenses and not just putting the blinders on and say, nope, this is the only way, right? So anyway, with all that said, Stuart McGill talks about understanding motions, postures, and loads. What motions make it worse? What postures make it better or worse? How can you load this and try to reproduce someone's pain, for one? And then how do you get them out of pain? See if you can reproduce a position, you know, motion, posture, load, to get them out of pain. And if you can't do that, then you have to put that person in a category of, is there an infection, a fracture, a tumor, cancer? Is there something else going on that we need more involved differential diagnosis? This person need a CT or an MRI or, you know, something, because we are going to see that stuff in practice at some point. In my 16 years of practice, I've at least identified or caught a couple of tumors, a couple of cases of cancer in the spine, and it was because of findings we saw on x-ray as well. So anyway, what does this mean? Motions, postures, loads. What does this mean? It means that you have to have an assessment. You have to be good at an assessment. Doing a movement assessment, doing an initial assessment where you're looking at what kind of things, you know, provoke pain, what kind of things relieve pain. Is the person better in a flexion bias? Does their pain decrease when they flex? Does their pain decrease when they extend? Does it hurt more when they flex or extend? Does it hurt more when they have a axial load? If they go up on their heels when standing and then dump down on their heels. Stuart McGill says that that's pretty much 1.5 times your body weight of load forcing down on the spine in an axial fashion. Is that a problem? If you're seated and you grab a seat below you and pull yourself into the seat in a bad decreased lumbar curve posture, is that something that tells you, okay, this is postural related? If you improve the lumbar curve, then pull yourself down, does it improve or get worse? And then from there, if you distract the spine, if you, you know, anti-shrug and lean over like a park bench and kind of lift your body up and decompress for 30 seconds to 60 seconds, does that give you 3 or 4 more minutes of walking without pain? Those are all signs and clues as to what's going on with the person. And then if it's an acute episode and there's, you know, a torn disc, a fissure where the actual nucleus, the gel from the nucleus is pushing through the fissure, if they're younger or older, younger people actually take longer to heal. Older people, he talks about that disc can gristle over, gristle, you know, like on a piece of meat. And so there's a period of time that you don't want to be having them do tons of range of motion and exercise initially. You want them to be improving posture, improving bracing, learn movement patterns like hip hinging. Crucial in these acute low back pain patients. Teach them a hip hinge as soon as possible, because that's typically the thing that's going to spare them from hurting their low back in that initial phase of getting out of that acute episode, and then allow them to heal before you start doing things like certain exercises. So it's important to know this stuff. That is the school of thought. That is the clinical process that we adhere to. And then as soon as we can start getting them engaged, figure out where there's mobility issues, we address mobility first. So we improve mobility in areas that are not mobile. Like, for example, in these low back patients, what do a lot of males with low back pain have in common? They have decreased hip mobility. Very, very common, right? So then, sorry, I'm just looking at a note on here. It's the first time looking down. Now I'm in my neighborhood. Yoni, what's going on? He says, gonna check this out. Cool, thanks for checking this out. Hope you're having a great day. So last thing is you know, first improving mobility. So you find out where these people have a mobility loss, and it's usually hips. Hip mobility is bad. So what happens if they have reduced hip mobility? When they walk, instead of their hip having that proper range of motion in the ball and socket joint, it doesn't. So their pelvis flex and extends significantly with walking, and then you cause lumbosacral hyperflexion extension, and a majority of these low back patients have an L4-5 or L5-S1 disc issue at the root of the cause. And you're gonna irritate that disc when there's a decreased hip mobility, then forcing the lumbar spine to flex and extend, okay? So anyway, those are just some thoughts, and it's the thought process of how to dig deeper and differentially diagnose and then fix your patients. And where does chiropractic fit in on this? Well, you better believe that adjusting a segment in the spine that is in a bad orthokinematic position as far as with motion, fixation, adjusting that joint specifically is going to be at the utmost of importance, but then knowing when to leave it alone as well, knowing when not to over adjust that joint and possibly cause a reduction in healing. You know, work on other areas in the spine, work on other extremities while you let that joint and that disc actually calm down. So it's funny how those things are the principles that kind of go back to what we learned initially when you really look at the work of Dr. Gonstead. You know, find it, fix it, leave it alone, understanding mechanics, really stressing the importance of patients to walk. You know, like Stuart McGill now talks about this, like one of the best types of rehab for a patient is walking. And if they can only walk for 3 minutes and they have pain, can they walk for 3 minutes? Go lean on a park bench, decompress for 30 seconds. If that reduces their pain, walk for another 3 minutes and do that again. Or walk 20 minutes morning, lunch, and evening. They now got an hour of walking in per day. That's a really good type of rehab to start forcing or retraining some abdominal bracing. So transverse abdominis, QL activation, but also helping just gently promote imbibition to the disc, getting some of the swelling out of the joint, but not going too hard where if that disc is starting to, what Stuart McGill says, scab over, you're not picking the scab. Interesting concept, right? Picking the scab. Think about what that means. If someone's disc is healing and you're doing too much with them, you're over adjusting them or you're over exercising them early on in that acute stage, you are not allowing the wound to heal. You're picking the scab. This other concept Stuart McGill talks about, which I thought was really cool, is he says in their research, and this is based on research, this is based on studies, it's not just some arbitrary number that he throws out there, but he says in this wide variety of low back pain patients that they've seen over the decades in his lab, okay, in his in vivo lab of patients coming in, differentially diagnosing them, taking them through this whole process of in-depth analysis and then corrective work, he says that 95% of these people did not need surgery and they spared them from surgery. 5% they sent off to surgery, okay? 95% did not need surgery. So what does that mean? That means that you can actually fix this stuff without sending them off to surgery. A lot of us chiropractors already know this, right? But have more faith in what we do, but also don't just be a flying seven chiropractor. Don't just hit them high, hit them low, roll them twice, let them go. That's not what this study is talking about. It's talking about specificity in your analysis and your application, which is extremely important. So it's not just because we have this chiropractic degree that it's like this ultimate badge of we get 95% results because of a study that a PhD in spine biomechanics said as far as we can fix low back pain without surgery. No, he's doing specific analysis, teaching them proper postural stuff, improving mechanics, avoiding things that flare them up, having proper case management. So that's what's really, really important. Chiropractic fits into that as far as our joint approach, absolutely. And just our knowledge base of spine biomechanics and how we put this whole plan together for a patient. So that's really what our job is, I feel like. And I'm up on the soapbox talking about this, is that we have to be skilled clinicians. And at 16 years into practice right now, I'm still trying to improve my clinical skills, my assessment. I'm always open to hearing what other people have to say. Just yesterday, I sent a Marco Polo over to, like I was saying earlier, Dr. Ed LaCara, the movement-based chiropractor. He is a smart dude. He is more up to date on the most current research than I am. I turn to him. He's my Cliff Notes version, right? And so I can talk to Ed and I can say, hey, Ed, I got this, this, and this. I tried this, this, and this. Just curious on your take. And he's such an awesome dude. What does he do? He sends me videos of going through different assessments and things with his patients, and he texts it to my phone. Okay, so thanks, Ed, if you're watching this or listening to this on a replay on a podcast. So appreciate it. Real quick, just take a second and say hi to everyone. So Yoni, Brandy, Ben, Dwayne, what's going on? Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining. The last thing I was going to say is that something that Stuart McGill talks about, which I thought was so cool, and I'm going to start doing this, and I've never said this before, but he says, because of the fact that 95% of these patients will respond if you assess them, differentially diagnose properly, and then treat them accordingly, that 95% are going to respond. So there's this concept of, like, when someone has surgery and then they get a certain result after surgery, and maybe they improve after surgery, was it the surgery that actually helped them, or was it the fact that they had to have a certain rest and recovery period after surgery? So what Stuart McGill says he does with patients who are in the super acute stage, who come in and they're like, hey doc, I hurt myself, I'm in horrible pain, I have sciatica, I've been like this for months, and I want you to fix me in like 5 minutes, you know, or like a week, and then I want to get back to my normal activity. He says what he does with patients is he says, I'm going to perform a virtual surgery. Okay, Mrs. Jones, so today we're performing a virtual surgery. And then he touches their lower back. He says, you just had virtual surgery. So now, because you've had virtual surgery, you have a rest and recovery period. That rest and recovery period is going to be 4 weeks before we return to start, you know, doing X, Y, and Z, 8 weeks, like depending on what's going on with them. And then from there, he says, so you need to treat this like you just had surgery. So that means you're going to do X, Y, and Z. And here's how that's going to work. And he lays it out for them. And I think a patient getting in that mentality of, if they want to get fixed, if they want to prevent a surgery, they have to modify their lifestyle, at least temporarily, through that initial acute healing phase. We have a couple of really severe acute low back pain patients right now with sciatica that we're working on. We're getting results with some of them slower, some quicker than others. And so, truth be told, I'm getting brushed up on as much stuff as I can, so I can just try to remind myself, is there something I'm missing? Is there something that I should be looking at? Like right now, I have this patient who has bad sciatica. He had horrible posterior knee pain, has a bilateral knee replacement. We worked on his knee. Okay, worked on his knee, got that 100%. How do we work on it? Well, I'm not adjusting his knee. He's got a knee replacement. He's got an artificial knee. He thought all the pain was coming from his sciatica referring into the back of his leg. Truth is, it wasn't. It was actually a knee issue as well. So we used pretty much the same protocol we would for setting a posterior tibia, where you take all the swelling and the edema from the back of the knee, because that's where it was located, and you work it down into the joint. We did some instrument-assisted soft tissue stuff in the back of his leg and his calf. And I'm not talking about like working on this for like 30 minutes of rehab and stopping everything you're doing. I'm talking about in the middle of a adjusting shift, spending 3 extra minutes doing this with the guy 3 times, his knee's 100%. So his knee's 100%. His referral pain into his leg is much improved, so less sciatic referral pain. He's got a big spondylolisthesis at L4 and L5. We've actually been specifically adjusting his fifth lumbar prone, setting it P to A, inferior to superior, trying to regain that normal arthrokinematics of the joint on L5 S1, because the joint's extremely fixated. And he's doing better, although he still has just temporary relief of his low back. So what are we turning to now? And I just talked to him about this yesterday. It's more of, what are your normal activities of daily living that you're doing? How are you moving? And then I started talking to him, and this is what kind of sparked me into like listening to some Stuart McGill stuff again, because remember, motions, postures, and loads. He's like, yeah, I sit in my recliner at home. And after I get up after 10 minutes, oh man, it kills me. If it's 5 minutes, it doesn't kill me. 10 minutes, it kills me. Well, let's look at how you sit. Sure enough, he's showing me how he sits. What does he do? Loses his just neutral spine, goes into almost a lumbar kyphosis, and it's after 10 minutes. So he has like creep in that bad position. his spine starts to migrate posteriorly, likely his fifth lumbar is going, you know, further into his direction of subluxation. And when he gets up, he's in lots of pain. So we spent a few minutes talking about, again with him, but teaching hip hinging. And then if you're going to be in a seated position, supporting to the point where you feel like you're almost pushing your belly out to at this point, increase that lumbar lordosis. And then really just reducing the sit time, which I told him initially, but I don't think he heard me. He was in so much pain. So it comes back to, like, it's not a one size fits all thing for everyone. You can't say, well, sitting's bad for you forever, so don't ever sit. Standing's bad for you forever, don't ever stand. It's, in most cases, you alternate that position of sitting and standing and really trying to avoid sitting as much as possible. If you do sit, you sit in a good neutral position. You engage the core. You keep a good neutral lumbar curve. But walking is one of the best types of rehab for a lot of these cases. But some cases, walking makes it worse. What if this person has an issue with the pelvic rim, has been compromised? Maybe they've been doing like heavy Bulgarian squats, you know, like one-legged squats. They have a inappropriate type of exercise prescription for them. They have an SI joint problem. They've been doing Bulgarian squats, torquing their pelvis, flaring up the superior portion of one SI joint, the inferior portion of the other SI joint. They have tons of SI joint pain. And now that person, when they walk, maybe it hurts the SI joint at first because it's so inflamed. So maybe they can't be walking at first. Maybe they have to do something non-weight bearing. Like maybe they need to be swimming or walking in a swimming pool, you know? So just knowing what types of things to recommend for various patients, but then ultimately doing bilateral motion eventually and walking is going to be a good thing for that patient once the initial inflammatory process in the SI joint decreases. And they shouldn't be doing that asymmetrical loading because that's going to be inappropriate for them. They can do it light. Maybe they were doing it too heavy. Maybe they weren't ready yet. So this whole like soapbox rant that I'm talking about here ties into as well as far as proper programming, you communicating with someone's personal trainer, making sure that they're putting together the correct exercise regimen for your patient, or if you're helping with a programming, that you're doing it correctly. So anyway, with that said, if you haven't already, if you're watching this and you're not familiar with Moveable University and how we take a lot of these concepts, not just clinically, but procedural wise, and we teach and we go through how to put it into a chiropractic clinic, check out MoveableUniversity.com. There's lots of cool stuff on there. And that's a key thing that I'm going to stress, is that a big part of what we've created and what we try to help other doctors with is the procedural part. That's the biggest hang up most of the time, is that we know we need to do this. We're passionate about this, but we're like, the thing that's holding me back is I just don't know how to fit it into my schedule. I don't know how to schedule my patients. I don't know how many staff I need. I don't know how long the patient should be in the practice for. I don't know how to bill for this. Can I get reimbursed for this? Is this going to be, you know, worth the time from a business standpoint in my clinic? I mean, so many different questions and things that need to be handled. And all these programs out there that teach the clinical stuff, which are great, and I would say learn as much as you possibly can, because that's what I do. I try to keep learning and learning and learning, but I've tried to distill that down to at least give you a good starting point with systems. But those things don't teach the procedural process. How do you do this in a chiropractic clinic? A lot of the people that do this type of work see one patient an hour, right? And that's not practical for a lot of us chiropractors, how we're set up. You know, I mean, we see multiple patients per hour, at a minimum four, maybe one every 15 minutes, you know? So like you have to have a team, staff, protocols that help assist you with this. Or if your model is one patient an hour, then you could still improve that with a lot of the systems and ideas and resources and automating the process. So anyway, something that we're going to have in the near future is we're going to start going through some more walkthroughs of behind the scenes of some of these systems that I'm actually mentioning right now. And if you check out the website, I believe you can get into a web class that we taught as well. I'll just throw that URL out there in case you want the direct one. It's moveableuniversity.com/masterclass. It goes through the four elements that you need for a successful exercise program in your practice. And it talks about what those four elements are. And a big one is automation. A big one is having automated systems. Automated systems help leverage your time to improve patient education, because there's a lot of education in this process. And if you're going to sit down with a patient one-on-one and explain all this stuff, you might be able to see 4 patients a day. And maybe that works for how you're set up practice-wise, but that's not going to work for us. And so that's where we had to come up with all these different systems. So anyway, sitting in my car in my driveway, I need to get inside and get ready to go to the clinic and see patients today. Because that's a cool thing too, is that the stuff we do, we actually do in practice. I practice full time, so I'm not someone that's like sitting on the sidelines trying to help other chiropractors with what they do, and I'm not doing it myself. I'm in the trenches with you. So check out movableuniversity.com. Appreciate everyone on here who supports us, who's part of our program. Dr. Ben Weiss says, yep. And sometimes picking a scab feels good. What feels good doesn't necessarily mean it's good for you. Yep, absolutely. The whole picking a scab concept. If you're just joining us now, go back in this and listen to what we're talking about as far as a disc healing, picking a scab. Looks like Dr. Mark Haynes is on here too. So cool. Thanks everyone for joining us. Talk to you soon. Leave some comments below. Appreciate you.